let's talk about joy. Let's get into it.
You are now in the cut with your boy, Keith Jefferson.
Hey, what's good, fam? This is God's bad boy, Keith Jefferson, coming at you with another episode in the cut. Hope things are well with you. Let's get into it. When we look at the journey in life, sometimes we forget the smell of the roses, to speak. And we let joy sometimes get taken away from us. But first, we got to understand what is joy. And for joy for the Christian is the joy that we find in Jesus Christ. In serving him, and also from his serving him, we also receive many blessings for our obedience that we have in him. But the thing that we often forget is that joy is also tied to others. Let me say that one more time. Joy is also tied to others, because society so many times can give us the definition of what joy is, but it totally misses the mark. So I'm here to tell you that joy is, number one, it is Jesus Christ. Number two is finding joy in others. And number three is making sure that you keep yourself last. I know this is in contrary to what it is that we believe in society today, because we hear things about telling our truth, and everything is an I type of ideology. But when we're talking about being in the body of Christ, we have to be the one who makes sacrifices for others. We are the low person on the totem pole in order to help others do all types of things, good times, bad things. So we're talking about being selfless. The Shema tells us that you should love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. So when we think about that, so we got to first love the Lord. Secondly, it tells us to love thy neighbor as thyself. And I've said this many times before. So with that, salvation is singular, but it's also corporate. And being in Christ is not only that you're saved there, but faith should also allow for you to exhibit the fruits of what it is that you say that you're faithful to, which means loving others. So we find joy in people, also in serving people. And this was the expression that Paul had when he addressed the church in Philippi. So when we look at the first chapter of Philippians, we see Paul is very excited. First off, he addresses the letter by saying that he is a bondservant of Jesus Christ. Bondservant, a Greek word, doulos, which means literally to be a slave. And a slave in the Roman times is pretty much the same as chattel slavery times, that individual had no rights of their own. What Paul is saying here is that he is a slave to Christ, and Christ directs his life. And this is a very important lesson. And we see this also in some of his other writings, and we see James say the same thing. In some of the other epistle letters, we see the same thing, is that these individuals are saying that their total life belongs to the Lord and is being guided by the Lord, not by their own volition. And that's very important. But Paul is very excited when he addresses the church in Philippi, because he said he thanks God all the time when he thinks of them. Now, how many times that you ask yourself, when you think of family and friends, do you just feel excited to think of them, to say a prayer for them? Because to me, saying a prayer for someone is one of the most loving and important things that you can do, because what you're asking the Lord is to intervene into their lives in a way that suits the Lord and also benefits that person that you're praying for. So a prayer for someone is the ultimate, one of the ultimate things for love. So when we look at it, we can always think back what Paul said. There is a joy in praying for others. And when we look at Paul's situation, there's a couple of things as we go and look at the first verses of Philippians. We go down from verses 1 through 8. We see that Paul thinks of them because of their steadfastness in the faith. What means that when he met and planted the church there, they clung to Christ. And they clung to Christ without any issue. They got down with him and said, hey, this is what we believe. And then they were very generous with their resources, because at this point, Paul was in jail. And in that, they sent support to Paul when he was in jail. And so that touched Paul's heart and say, you know what? This is the ultimate show of respect, that something I didn't even ask for, but they poured out their generosity to me in order to make me have some comfort. And then thirdly, he's expressing an unending concern for the people. And that's something you got to really think about. And I'm going to come back to that. And then the third thing, he talks about their role they have played in the ministry. Now, going back to the third point, and this is the point that I want to dwell on for a minute, is how many times do we go through things? Because again, Paul is in prison. And at this point, he don't know for sure if he's going to live, if he's going to be released. But in spite of his circumstances, he found joy in thinking of others. Now, how many times in life do we get so short-sighted that when we're going through trials and tribulations, that we become so intertwined with what's going on in the now that we forget to smell the roses and think about the people who love us, who's helped us, who's made sacrifices for us, who's rolled with us, who's held us down? How many times have we been in that situation? Because we get in this mode where we're constantly complaining and looking at the problem instead of looking at the problem solver. And that was the attitude. That was the attitude when Paul was writing this letter. He was finding joy in remembering others who love Christ just as much as he does. And that's key, because salvation is singular, but it's also corporate, because we need one another on this Christian journey to help us to get through some tough situations. In this instance, we see Paul relying on the love of the Philippians to give him strength. And in that, he's not concerned about his own situation, but he's more impressed with, and what he's thinking about, is that their love for Christ, their sacrificial generosity, and the role they have played in sustaining his ministry. Now, that's something to say, and I can dwell on this all day, because, again, we get in a funk that we don't want to dwell on anything but the situation that we in. But the thing is that we have to take self-focus off ourselves. And when we take self-focus off ourselves, our focus has to be directed towards Jesus Christ. Now, you heard me say before that people often say the Lord won't put anything on you, any more on you than you can bear. I differ with that ideology. For one, it's not biblical. But if you're going to go and look at certain truths, I will say this. I will always say that the Lord will put more on you than you can bear, so you can learn to trust in him. So in all situations, so we're looking at this, and this is just being brief, going through these few verses. When we look at these few verses, we see that Paul had a play on words. He said that he was a slave, well, a bondservant, which means slave, of Christ. While he was physically in chains in the house of Caesar, he was also in chains of Jesus Christ. So in that, he knew that his life wasn't his own, and that regardless of the situation, he belonged to Christ. And that's the type of mentality that we have to be in when we go into different situations, when we're facing opposition from all different angles, that we belong to Christ. And we serve a king who is willing and able to supply abundantly in any situation that we're in. The thing is that we got to trust and we got to believe in him. But in the meanwhile, for me, the best thing to do is when you're going through trials, when you're going through situations, is to reach out and love other people. And that's exactly what Paul did. He said, in spite of, you all bring me joy because you have partnered with me in loving Christ and sharing the gospel. Therefore, even in this situation that I am, you bring me great joy. So Paul turned a negative into a positive, and we'll jump into the rest later on. Look here, y'all have a blessed week. Let's not dwell on the negative things that happens because, again, we have a Lord and a Savior, Jesus Christ, who can supply abundantly. So let's make sure we're doing our part in loving each other, loving your neighbor, loving your coworker, even through difficult circumstances. Keep them in your prayer because I have learned not to pray for situations, but to pray for people. All right, fam, till we speak again. Grace and peace.